Crosley has made a lot of crappy record players, but this is not one of them. This is the Crosley Collegiate Portable Turntable, model CR6010A. Comes in either two-tone blue and white or red and white. You get a metal speaker grill with two 4-ohm speakers in there for stereo sound, and they have good-sized magnets on them. So, despite the small size, they have pretty decent sound. And it has nice retro styling with these metal latches to hold it closed. And you can open it up and remove the lid. And the biggest advantage of this model is that it has an Audio-Technica AT3600 magnetic cartridge. It's one of the very few models Crosley has made that does not use a cheap ceramic cartridge. It is a 3-speed turntable for 33, 45, and 78 RPM. The included stylus is only for playing LPs and 45s. If you want to play 78s, you can purchase a 3mm stylus. You get on-off and volume, tone control, headphone jack, and on this side you get an aux input if you want to plug something in, like an iPod, and use the built-in speakers and amplifier. And a USB connection for recording your vinyl to your computer so you can turn it into CDs or MP3s. On the back is the 12-volt power supply connection. It comes with a wall wart power supply. It does not run on batteries, but you can easily connect the 12-volt battery to this and run it on that. Underneath is a storage compartment for storing the power supply. This one happens to be made in July 2012. Crosley's list price is $150, but the retail price varies from around $80 to $120, and it's well worth the money, except for one problem that a lot of people have, is that the auto shutoff feature of the turntable cuts off too soon when you're playing 45s or some 78s, and there's no switch to disable the auto shutoff. There is a newer revision of this model which does have a switch to turn off the auto stop. So if you have one of these newer versions, then the modification I'm going to show in this video does not apply to you. But keep watching, because I'll also show you how to adjust the speed and the tracking force of the turntable. The only tools you need are a Phillips screwdriver, a pair of cutters, and a flat blade screwdriver. And while you're at it, you can also adjust the tracking force and the speed of the turntable, and I'll show you how to do that as well. The first thing you want to do is remove the C-clip holding the platter in place. That's where you use your flat blade screwdriver to pry it out. I found the best way to do that is to alternate between pushing either side of the screwdriver and use your other hand to sort of hold it a little bit so it doesn't go flying when you pop it off. Once you pop off the C-clip, you can just pull up on the platter, and the belt will come out along with it, but don't worry, because it's very easy to get the belt back on when you're done. And once you have the platter removed, you'll see three screws here with rubber bushings on them. That's how the mechanism is mounted to the base. So you got to remove those three screws. And once you have it unscrewed, you just take out the screws and they come out along with these plastic bushings. Now these two are the same, but this one, the bushing is a little bit shorter, so keep that in mind when you go to put them back together. Here's the part of the mechanism that causes the problem. Right now the tone arm is in the rest position. You can see there's a switch right here, and this part of the little thing that's attached to the tone arm is causing the switch to be open, which causes the motor to shut off. Now as I move the tone arm as if I'm going to start playing a record, you can see this thing moves out of the way and that thing drops down, closing the switch and allowing the motor to run. And as the tone arm goes towards the center of the record, you can see there's another part of the mechanism, this little plastic nub here, which begins to rub against the switch again, causing the motor to shut off as it gets towards the center of the record. And unfortunately, they designed it so that this action happens too soon as it gets towards the center of the record, causing it to shut off too early when playing 45s and some 78s. So there's two things you could do. You can get rid of this tab here, which would cause the switch to be closed all the time, so whenever the turntable is turned on, the motor would run. But if you want to have it so that the motor would stop when the tone arm is in the rest position, there's another thing you can do. You can cut off part of this tab here so that as it gets towards the center of the record, this part will no longer rub against the switch. So what I'm going to do is going to take a pair of cutters and cut off this plastic tab on this end. That way there will be nothing to hit the switch as the tone arm gets to the center. And the only downside of that is that when you get to the end of the record, it would just keep spinning in the middle groove. But at least in this case, since this part would still be working, when the tone arm is in the rest position, the motor would shut off. I'm just gonna cut off that part of plastic there. There we go. Let's see if that worked. So now I'll move the tone arm towards the middle, and there we go, it no longer hits the switch. You can see when it's in the rest position, then it hits the switch, but now towards the center, there's nothing there to hit the switch. So that's all we need to do to fix the problem. And while we have this thing apart, you can also see the speed adjustment for the motor. Now on the motor itself, there's two trimmers inside there marked L and H for low and high. It's basically a two-speed cassette motor that they used for the turntable. L is for 33 and a third, that's the low speed, and H is for 45 RPM. And then there's another trimmer down here which is for 78. Now to get to these, you probably need a plastic adjustment tool, because if you use a metal tool, it might ground out against the metal case of the motor. Here's the color TV alignment tool kit that I just got on eBay for about $7. And it comes with this yellow one that has just the right size to do the adjustment. So what you do is you stick it into the motor. First you have to get through that rubber gasket. And then you twist it around and you feel where it drops down. And once it drops down, that's when it's in the groove to adjust the motor. And you just twist it left or right. And same thing with this one. There, just drop down into the adjuster. Only trick is there's no easy way to do this while you're playing a record, because obviously you have it all taken apart now without even a platter on. One thing you could try to do is have some kind of grip to suspend this up in the air and then put the platter and belt back on while it's still hanging up here, and then you can stick your tool from underneath and that's how you can adjust it. And here's the easiest thing to do, is to adjust the tracking force. The manual doesn't tell you about this, but I happened to discover it myself. There's this metal counterweight at the end of the tone arm, and you can actually adjust it. Mine came with it screwed all the way in, which is the heaviest tracking force. But if you want to make it lighter, you just unscrew it, and you notice it starts to stick out more. And you can keep going until it gets really stiff. It's not going to come off all the way. But you can feel it getting really stiff, and that's about as much as it can go out. And that's the lightest tracking force. And there's also a threaded hole in the back of the counterweight, so if you want to make the tracking force even lighter, you can get a screw, and you can screw on various and sundry washers and bushings to add more counterweight to make the tracking force even lighter. And when you go to put the platter back on, you notice there's two little plastic nubs at the edge of the platter on the bottom of it, and what you do is you stretch out the belt to go on one of those nubs, and when you put the platter back on, you make sure the motor spindle is on the inside of the belt here, and that way you can put the platter down all the way and then just twist it and the belt will pop off the nub here and right onto the motor spindle. I'll try to show you that right now. You can see I have the platter partially on the spindle and the belt is stretched out right on top of where the motor spindle is. So now I'm going to drop it down all the way and I'm going to twist it clockwise, and I think it got on the motor. Yes, it did. So that's a very easy way to reinstall the platter in the belt. Now, with the modification complete, we can turn it on. You notice the motor's not spinning when the tonal arm is in the rest position. But once we start putting it towards the center to play a record, it starts spinning. And now, with that little plastic tab removed, we can go all the way to the center and it still keeps turning. So that way the auto shutoff is defeated. Now with the modification complete, it'll no longer stop at the middle of the record. And you get that classic sound of the record needle in the inner groove. So you just have to pick up the tone arm when you're done. And this thing must have some pretty big filter capacitors in it, because I had this thing sitting for at least a year waiting for me to figure out how to do this modification. And even before I connected the power supply, such as right now there's nothing connected to it, I turned it on and the power indicator LED came on and stayed on for a good long time. So right now it's not powered by anything. And you can see it took quite a long time for that indicator to go out.